And this is the Tet?
Yeah.
We're actually riding on the Tet, yeah? That's the Trans Euro Trail, the Tet, the car coming. As you can see, out on the motorcycle again, there's Chug, there's my friend Dickie there, he's on his Himalayan, and we met this nice gentleman here on his Triumph. That's a nice machine you got there, isn't it?
Yeah, it's not bad.
Street, like a street bobber.
Bonneville bobber, yeah.
The Bonneville bobber. Anyway, we just had a bite to eat at Dom's bike stop. This is a good place for us to stop on the way. It's about 80 miles from home. Get ourselves warmed up, get some coffee and some food for our journey onward. We've got another about 65 miles to run before we get to our destination, which is Snowdonia. So I'll bring you back when we're near our destination. I reckon we're going to get there about half an hour before it gets dark. Look at that lovely scenery as we make our way towards Snowdonia. And what a nice day. The sun is shining. It's a bit cold though. What a green and pleasant land this is. Look at that. Although I'm currently stuck in a bit of a queue. There's some roadworks down here. It's not a very long one, we'll be through these in no time. This rather grand high street, this is Welshpool. Apparently it's the gateway to Wales, they say. Now we've got 29 more to run. That's it, we are more or less here. This is it, just down here. This is where our campsite is. Look at that for a view, isn't that wonderful? Alan's turned up on his lovely Tenere.
Yeah.
Now, on the way here, we were coming up a hill, Dickie was doing 60, and then I heard him change down. He said he had no more guts, no more go in it.
Yeah.
And then we stopped halfway here, and he kept saying, Tenere, Tenere. And then you've pulled in just now, and he's just said, what have you just said?
Well, I've been looking at these things.
Come into the shop, come into the shop. You've been looking at them?
If I didn't have that, I'd be seriously looking at one of these.
So the question is, Dickie, should I sell Chug and Strom and buy one of these for next year?
Yeah.
I think it's the best. I reckon they're the best all-rounder. Like I say, I rode that Harley the other day.
Yeah.
That big Harley Pan-Am. It's just too heavy.
Well, I like doing a bit of green laning. And not that I'll do anything extreme on this, but there's a green lane at the back, just over there. I went down there. And it is heavy, but I mean, what I've seen on
the... Nowhere near what that Pan-American,
that's terrible. Ridiculous.
Then you've got all your BMWs, they're all much the
same. I wouldn't forgive myself if I was holding
these. These are, you wouldn't.
No, Well, here's the setup tonight. It's getting cold. It is getting cold, there's no doubt about it. It's going to get down to around about zero, maybe a touch below. So I'm in my four season Rab 700 Ascent sleeping bag, a down bag. And underneath that is the Neo Air. I'm going to be cosy tonight. I've got a pillow at the top there. Morning everyone, slept well last night. I'm having big breakfast. Look, big breakfast. You're having a laugh, aren't you? So that's it, let the adventure begin. We're heading off to ride through some stunning scenery and we're hoping to find an ancient Neolithic monument known as the Crown of Thorns, which is going to entail a bit of a walk as well. Well, we set off from the campsite, riding some wonderful roads, heading north and west to pick up the coast road, which would eventually bring us to Barmouth, where we would stop for some refreshment. And on the way we would go across a lovely toll bridge, which you'll see shortly in this video. And then further on throughout the day, pick up some lovely rural lanes and country roads. And at one point we'd ride along part of the Tet National Trail, the Trans-Euro Trail, in search of the Crown of Thorns. Now the Crown of Thorns is something I've always wanted to see. I've seen it on the internet, I've seen images of it, I've got to go and see it with my own eye. It's known as the Crown of Thorns, but its other name is, and I'm probably going to be pronouncing this wrong, it's Bryn Cadar Faner, which I think roughly translates to something like the hill crowned with the throne of the flag. It's spectacular, that's all I can say. And we couldn't ride the bikes there, we had to walk, that was a bit of an adventure, and you'll see that in a minute. This is a gated road by the looks of it. Narrow road, no parking.
Oh, back behind you there.
Yeah.
It's all cadaverous, and in the summer.
You can't see it, can you?
Around here, that you can't. You can only see a third of it.
So that's cadaverous behind, then, is it?
Yeah.
Not that you can see it, but. The weather's very inclement, but all that mountain range behind me in the mist, that's Cadar Idris. Beautiful, a beautiful location. The weather has turned very inclement now. We're just leaving Cadar Idris behind. Cool. Miserable. I've had to put my waterproof trousers on. I didn't expect to see the sea. Yeah, look at that. Look. Yeah, there's Barmouth, I can see it, yeah. Hairpin bends though, coming down here. Look at that, lovely. Absolutely cracking. Another hairpin bend. Cool, you couldn't wish for a better motorcycling. And the river down there on the right. That was nice going down there, wasn't it?
Beautiful.
It is beautiful.
So coming around and seeing the sea.
Yeah, yeah. That was a surprise, wasn't it? Right, we're coming up to the bridge at Barmouth now, where you're allowed to ride your motorcycle across. Oh, I've got to pay. Toll bridge. Oh, yeah. How much is it, Alan? Oh, okay. That's the toll keeper. Pienmepool Toll Bridge, it says. Thank you. So it's a wooden bridge. £50 to get across it. Well, that's looking back up into the hills, and then we're coming down to Barmouth now, and over there is a bridge. I reckon the best thing, the way to see that, is to stick the drone up whilst it's dry. The bridge at Barmouth, what a lovely bridge this is. Been across it once, that's in a previous video. I think I did that earlier this year. Anyway, I think it was opened, according to Wikipedia, in October 1867, 10th of October 1867 to be exact. The bridge is 820 metres long. In Old English or even Old Welsh, that'd be 900 yards. And it's a single line with a pedestrian stroke cycleway, which you can also ride motorcycles on. And I guess it's also called a viaduct. I think it's called a viaduct. Currently, there's work going on the bridge. They're actually restoring it or repairing it. Very, very scenic bridge. A lovely piece of architecture. Yeah, Harlech, famous for its castle, which is very impressive. Look at that. Right, we're starting to head at the quieter roads once again, in search of the Crown of Thorns. We can't actually ride to the Crown of Thorns, we've got to walk about a mile. But Alan's put into his sat nav destination to the closest point. I just see Dickie pointing at the walls and all the moss. And this reminds me of something that Dickie told me not long ago. He said basically this is a rainforest. It's got a microclimate and it's always damp. You can see all the moss. And this is the Tet. We're actually riding on the Tet, yeah? That's Trans Euro Trail, the Tet, the car coming. So, yeah, Alan's got the map, the Tet, the Trans Euro Trail.
Did you see all the moss on
the... Yeah, I saw it.
This is that micro climb.
Yeah, you said the rainforest.
Yeah.
I just told my viewers that. Apparently we've got to turn around and go up here, I think. Yeah, looks like we're going this way. Quite a steep incline. Chug this tractor in up in first gear. Nice hairpin bend. Right, it's nice up here. I bet this is bleak in the winter up here. Oh, do you fancy living there then, Dickie? Could do with a new window. This is the sort of road these bikes are made for.
I think this is it.
Pardon? We've got to find somewhere to park the bike then.
Yeah.
So this is our destination point. We're here, Dickie. We've got to park the bikes up. Pretty rough terrain to find the Crown of Thorns. I've got to say, at this point, one of the hardest things that I've ever done is to hike. Well, tell you what, I've done a bit of hiking in my time. I've carried heavy packs, I've walked long distances, but I've never done it wearing motorcycle kit. And I'll tell you what, it's the hardest hiking I've ever done. Give it a try, it'll wear you out, something chronic. Anyway, we slogged on through the wilderness of Wales, through bog and mire, and on several occasions Dickie and Alan put their foot in it. I luckily remained dry. and we walked our way gently to the Crown of Thorns.
Good things got to come to an end.
Yeah, in the drizzle, in the rain.
The weather's come in, unfortunately. So we're heading back home now. We've got 140 miles to go. I was going to do a review on the bike fitting.
Yeah, that'd be a good idea.
But I don't know if now's the right time to do it or not. But what I could do is ask Dickie, because he's had his bike. I'll wait a minute, I'll make sure you're in shop, right there, a sec.
Yeah, perfect. You're in shop.
Okay. The camera I'm using.
Yeah, it's recording.
The camera I'm using hasn't got a viewfinder facing me, so I can't see what the camera sees, so I'll just have to go and check. But Dickie's had his bike about a year more than I've had mine, hasn't he?
Mm, yeah.
I've had mine exactly 2 years, he's had yours 3 years.
Three, yeah.
What mileage have you got from it?
I've got about 14,500 on there now. So
14,500. Now, I don't know about you, with me I've had a sort of a love-hate relationship with it.
Yeah.
But I find it an endearing bike.
Oh, they're lovely bikes. Yeah.
They've got a few little quirks, a few little problems, yeah. But I find them endearing bikes. So you come from a background of, you've been motorcycling for 40 odd years, haven't you?
Yeah.
You've had a mixture of bikes,
yeah.
Big and small, powerful.
Yeah, mostly Harleys. And if you ride a Harley, especially an old one, you can jump on one of these and you feel straight at home.
Yeah.
They're a bike that, you know, you have to look after, but they're reliable. They just have the odd little thing, you know, that you have to get your spanners out now and again, which is, to me, normal for motorcycling anyway. You know.
So, these bikes, they sort of harken back to an age when, if things go wrong, you've got an ability to fix it at home.
Yeah.
With the brand new bikes coming out of the factories now, you've had it.
It's like the KTM, if you like.
Yeah.
1290 KTM. and if that decides that, you know, it's not going to work,
yeah,
job done. There's nothing I can do about it.
Nothing you can do about it.
Call the RAC on a trailer, KTM dealership, plug it in.
But with these, you can fix them.
These, you can get your spanners out, and, well, I think they were built, so wherever you ride in the world,
yeah,
there's somebody that will be able to
repair it for you.
If you're not mechanically minded, they'll be able to repair it for you.
Yeah, yeah.
I think they're absolutely amazing little bikes.
Yeah. So after 10,000 mile on mine, 14,000 mile on yours, we give them a thumbs up.
Absolutely, yeah.
Yeah, yeah. We give them a thumbs up.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you what, I'm glad I got my Suzuki.
I'm glad I got my KTM.
I'll see you in the next one. Bye for now.
Bye.